Everybody, this is Dr. Ed Park. We are going to be talking about injection techniques today, so hopefully we can all learn something. What we see on the picture here in the introduction is the various color-coded sizes of needles, and of course the gauges, the lower the number, the wider the diameter of the bore of the needle. There are many needles that I carry around, different shapes, lengths, even different tips for different reasons. So, as a way of disclaimer, the use of exosomes has not been FDA approved for the treatment or prevention of any disease. This video is an educational video, not meant to be an advertisement. And the anecdotes that we'll touch upon are merely anecdotes based on an experience, and they are not rigorous scientific evidence. The goals of the talk will be to talk about what it feels like to be a doctor. Most people are not doctors, and they don't really understand what that means. We'll get into IV versus local injections, nasal, spinal, shoulders, knees, hips. Those are common areas that we inject. Nerves and arteries also, muscles, tendons, we won't mention, but there's also two new techniques that I'm getting more comfortable with, intraperitoneal and transtympanic. For those that don't know, exosomes are not cells. They are 1/300th the diameter. therefore, they don't have their own machinery to copy DNA, to make proteins. They're merely the messages, the letters, the FedEx packages, if you will, that they use to communicate with other cells. The exosomes that we use don't have self-antigens. Certain exosomes from immune cells can have self-antigens, but self-antigens are what cause the reactions. And graft versus host, host versus graft, rejecting foreign stem cells, et cetera. It's really hard to remember anatomy. A phrase that comes to mind is, I've forgotten more than most people will ever know. So if we just look at these four charts, for example, the muscle man shows there's a lot of different muscles with a lot of different names. The bone man tells us there's a lot of bones with a lot of different names and functions and different variations of anatomy. The circulatory system varies quite a bit. The arteries, of course, go out, the veins come back. And luckily, during embryogenesis or during the development of the fetus, the nerves tend to follow the arteries, but the nervous system also very complex. Above me is a picture taken from the course I took almost 3 years ago on ultrasound-guided injections. And, you know, despite the fact that most of the participants were doctors, not everyone felt comfortable doing injections. And this brings me to sort of the leitmotif of the lecture, which is that it's very hard to be a doctor. In the old days, they used to respect doctors, Marcus Welby. Nowadays, everyone thinks, well, I do a little research on the internet, the same thing. But there's two kinds of doctors. You know, there's physicians who mostly think, and the expression is, don't just do something, stand there. And then for surgeons, it's the opposite. They love to do procedures, and they can actually get into a flow state. As an OBGYN, I experience this quite a bit. You know, you do something that requires a lot of skill, but it's easy. And so you kind of, it's relaxing to do something like a C-section, open a person up, take their baby out safely, and close them up safely and expertly. You know, I think my record was 14 minutes for that. So they said, used to joke in OBGYN, we only do four things. We take out a baby and a uterus from above and from below. But those things are quite non-trivial to master. And in residency, you get to see a lot of different variation, technique, and skill. And what people don't really talk about is the fear factor. I mean, surgeons often get into trouble because they are unwilling to take the appropriate amount of risk in what they're doing. And you see it all the time. And it's very hard to master your emotions while you're in that moment, knowing that there are downsides, not only for the patient, but therefore for yourself, if you screw up. So not everyone is comfortable with procedures, and it's always a learning curve. Of course, the easiest thing and the thing that's most widely practiced is intravenous therapy. And people will say, well, that's just the same as putting it where the ache or the problem is. I don't know if that's true. It does have the benefit of being easy and quick. When we think about that, we think about this chart above me. This is radio-labeled mesenchymal stem cells, and it shows where they are in 20 minutes, in 2 hours, 6 hours, 2 days, 7 days, and 10 days. And what we see is, as a general principle, is where the blood circulates. It goes to the lungs, of course, but it also gathers in the spleen, and it gathers in the liver. And so I think the same thing might apply, especially if they're docked to a lot of these immune cells, to the exosomes. So think of exosomes as Nerf balls. They're just phospholipid bilayer membrane spheres that have some docking proteins on them, but mainly they can dock to any cell. So you probably want to start them where you have the biggest problem. Yes, they will diffuse out. But I think location, as in real estate, is important. They are small enough to cross the blood-brain barrier. The blood-brain barrier is illustrated in the cartoon to my left. And there are many aspects to that. There is variable permeability. But certainly, I think the analogy I use, maybe overuse, is it's like putting food coloring in a swimming pool. I mean, it's going to color the whole pool. But probably if these things are going to stick and act on the cells where the first come, first serve basis, you probably want to start them out where they're needed. Start them in the knee and let them leak out. One of the techniques that I think I'm the only one doing, some people are sniffing them, refrigerate the exosomes and sniff them. But I think the rationale is clearly a good one. You see above that the nasal canal sinuses, they have blood circulation that is shared with the brain. To the left, the veins, the blue things, drain up into the brain. And there are nerves that go directly from the floor of the skull into the olfactory area and through the, what's called the cribriform plate. So through the veins and through the nerves, these exosomes can get into the brain, I do believe. People think, well, where in the nose are you injecting? We're injecting it just under the slimy, smooth mucous skin, the mucosa. And people don't really know, but there are three like shelves coming in like this called the conchae. And these are kind of turbulent air circulating bony shelves, and they're lined with the mucous membrane. So that's where we're injecting. What we do is we put some lidocaine gel to numb up the area, and then we sterilize it with betadine. And I'm really happy with the vibrational distraction. We have a little vibrating device that we could put on the skull, and it creates so much neurological noise, I guess you could say, that people rarely even feel the 32 gauge needle going in. What is a little uncomfortable is the infusion of a little bit of fluid. That's why we can only use a cc at most. People get a little sneezing, maybe a little tearing of the eye, but in general, it's pretty well tolerated. And most people say, oh, that wasn't as bad as I thought. And the purpose of this would be to get into the brain. If you want to really, really affect the brain, we recommend the triple strength. That would be 3 billion per cc per nostril. A lot of fear, a lot of confusion about what a back injection is. Of course, a lot of people have back problems. What's illustrated above me is the lumbar or lower back vertebrae in cross-section sagittally. And what we see here is that at this level, well, the basic anatomy is that the spines or the things coming out the back, like the, what do you call it, stegosaurus, they are more horizontal. People ask me, why don't you inject in my neck? My neck hurts. Well, in the neck and the thoracic spine, they're actually more diagonal. So they form like a real barrier to entry, even if you curl the person forward. Whereas in the low back, they shoot straight out and there's a nice wide area that you can enter a needle into. And when you're entering the needle, look in the middle top diagram and you see that the needle is trying to get into this potential epidural space. It's actually, if you believe the cartoon to the left, about a 1 centimeter wide space from when you enter the ligament surrounding that area to the dura mater, which is the sheath of the spinal cord, is about a centimeter of area. And it's actually not a difficult technique. You see this in every labor and delivery room in the country. The anesthesiologist comes in and he's able to work on someone who's having pain, heavy breathing, physically distorted. You can get in there, and what they do is they thread a catheter for continuous anesthesia infusion. What we do is much easier. We just, in the picture to my left, we get a little syringe. We get about, it's usually 3 to 4 centimeters in. We get in and we start pumping the plunger and advancing it very, very minutely. And when we hit the epidural space, the plunger loses its resistance. We know we're there. It's quite an easy technique. Interestingly, the cartoon to the lower left shows what's more important, and the cartoon in the middle top is wrong. The spinal cord, that yellow thing where your nerves are coming through, the cabling, it ends at about T12, L1. So down below that level where we're entering around L3, L4 usually, there is no spinal cord. They're just hairs of the horse, the cauda equina or the horse tail. What's much safer even still, you're not gonna puncture the spinal cord. So it's a pretty safe procedure. Indeed, one of the things I'm trying to get better at is using ultrasound to inject, not for the epidural, because that's super easy without fluoroscopy and adds nothing, but actually for the facet joints, which are these articulating joints to the side where the vertebrae rotate and move on each other. The shoulder is a super easy one to do. Most commonly, we're trying for the subacromial bursa, and that's illustrated above me. We take a needle, we go from behind the shoulder blade, and in the shoulder blade, there's a ridge. We go right under that, and we aim for this area, the acromioclavicular joint. This is one of those techniques I learned during that two-day seminar, and it's more clearly illustrated by the skeleton. The syringe goes in, it goes about 3-4 inches usually into the subacromial bursa. And that's, the bursa is right above where the rotator cuff muscles are. So getting in that area is genuinely adequate. Although sometimes I will approach the actual painful muscles from the side or the front as well. Of course, we numb the skin with 1% lidocaine, tiny needle, they barely feel it. And then we prep the skin with betadine. Everything is done sterilely. It's very important to do that. There may be slight pain, generally well tolerated, but that's only when we touch the bone. There's not a lot of nerves inside the body, just mainly on the surface of the body. And there's a little risk from the posterior approach. Whereas if you look at this anatomical cartoon on the left, you see that if you approach the shoulder from the front, there's all kinds of stuff going through there, nerves, arteries, veins. It's very dangerous. So in this instance, I don't usually use ultrasound as long as I start with a posterior approach or the anatomy is normal. A very, very common, probably the most common joint procedure is knees. And I often get feedback from patients. They say, well, my other doctor did it this way. And that's a technique that we learned, this way being above, injecting with an ultrasound, watching the needle enter the bag of fluid. The problem is that the bag of fluid or the suprapatellar bursa communicates 85% of the time, which means that 15% of the time it doesn't communicate with the knee joint. So if your disease is in the knee joint, arthritis, meniscal tear, ligament sprain, then you're not even getting it into that watertight area. So a better approach, in my opinion, is to go into the knee joint. Because of the way that the ligaments are, they go from outside to in, like your hands in your pockets. it's generally better to go on the lateral side of the patellar ligament, but we can go on either side because you don't really want to be injecting directly in the ligament. It's a little painful. And we have done that. And part of clinical medicine is making mistakes and knowing from those mistakes. So if we look at the cartoon to my left, the anatomy is shown. So I usually get a patient to dangle from a high chair so that the space is open. A lot of times because it's bone on bone, it's really worn down. It's harder to get in the space, but I've never failed to get in. You can even get a little traction on their lower leg to open that space up a little more. But it's very doable, and it's, I think, right where you want to get the stuff, right in the knee joint. You don't want to mess around with suprapatellar bursa. The hips, in contradistinction, are something that I always use an ultrasound for. I have the $7,000 ultrasound that really is just a probe that connects to a tablet. And so the reason for that is shown to my far left. Coming down is the nerve and the artery and the vein passing under the inguinal ligament or coming from the belly down to the leg. And so if you're just blindly sticking needles, you can injure some pretty critical structures there, and that's not a good idea. So in general, you want to come from the side, but you always want to use an ultrasound because you can watch the needle and see it very clearly from entering the skin, going through the muscle, and then above me going right into the joint capsule, and it's very satisfying. You can see the fluid going into the joint capsule, and you know exactly where you're at. The hips are not just the hip joint. Actually, most people are not very good at determining what's wrong with them. Some people are. I had a physician colleague of mine who I injected. He knew exactly what muscle it was. To my immediate left, you see the hamstring tendons inserting on the ischial tuberosity. And of course, you know, we were able to do an ultrasound injection. And the advantage is you can see it going right into the appropriate tendon. You can also visualize the sciatic nerve, which is very painful if you touch it or inject it. And that runs very close by. Other things that can be felt as hip pain are these sort of hip abductors, external rotators, the piriformis, the superior gemellus, the obturator internus, and the quadratus femoris. Think of these as like the rotator cuff muscles of the hip, if you will. Another boon is the ultrasound for localizing the nerves and the arteries. Remember I told you that the nerves and the arteries tend to be right next to each other? So you could turn on the Doppler flow in this little portable ultrasound and it'll show you the Doppler shift. Fast flow is, it looks red and you can see that nice round artery. It's usually not that hard to find anyway because it's moving, it's pumping. But above to the left, you see a nerve circled in the dashed yellow line. And this is actually quite easy to find with the ultrasound as well. Some people have like carpal tunnel syndrome. They might have some inflammation of that median nerve, but nerves are pretty easy to find using the ultrasound. They have a honeycomb sort of appearance. And you can also, as shown above me, turn on the ultrasound flow and see the pulsatile red circle. For certain things like facial nerve palsy, I used to do it kind of by ultrasound. It wasn't super helpful. Actually, now I have a better approach that I've done on a couple of people where I just get the facial nerve as it's exiting the stylomastoid foramen. And because of the less risk of damage to other structures and arteries, this is a good approach, I feel. And so again, everything is just refinement of technique. The second to last thing I'd like to talk about is intraperitoneal. Intraperitoneal is sounds very scary. And indeed, we did a procedure a couple of weeks ago with my mom and she was freaked out by it, but there's a lot of space there. And if you follow the needle, as shown to my left, directly down with the ultrasound, you could see it tenting the peritoneal cavity, which is the area where all the intestines are. And you could see it tenting and poking through. And you could see it quite safely entering the fluid-filled space. And it's very unlikely that you're going to injure a bowel at all because you're watching the needle the entire time. Above me is the localization. You generally go about 3 centimeters medial and 2 centimeters cephalad. And then this is a pretty safe area, avoiding this thing called the inferior epigastric artery, which you do not want to nick. And that just kind of brings us back to the point that doctors, more than anything, need to be aware of their own limitations and need to review the anatomy. Every time I do a procedure, I review the anatomy over and over again, make sure I'm clear on it. And then we can do something that requires a lot of skill, but is somehow yet relaxing. Finally, this transtympanic, I have high hopes for. We'll see how it goes. I just spoke with a young man who had the procedure 2 weeks ago, and his hearing is back to normal, but his tinnitus is yet to resolve. But there's a wide variety of problems for which we don't have a good solution, ranging from Meniere's disease, which is a cochlear disease, a lot of overlap with what they call cochlear high drops. They get a feeling of fullness, they get tinnitus, hearing loss and vertigo, or the sensation that the room is spinning, lack of balance because of the effect on the semicircular canals. Hyperacusis is a different problem, which is inability to dampen the sound transmission. There are two muscles, the tensor tympani and the subpedius, which kind of dampen that snare drum. And those can be affected by nerve and muscular and I guess even bony problems. Vertigo is that spinning from the semicircular canals, which is the side, those three XYZ axis loops that come off of the cochlea or the snail. And the snail is implicated in tinnitus or ringing in the ears, but it also can be at the neurons, the junction boxes, and in the brain as well. And then, of course, just as with the eyes, lose elasticity, the ability to see close up. We have presbyopia, the inability to see close up from fine accommodation. And we have presbyacusis, meaning the loss usually of the high frequency range at first, part of aging, which is really stem cell death, degeneration, telomere dysfunction, epigenetic silencing, who knows. But as we get older, we lose our hearing. And so the technique shown above is you take this little phenol aliquot dispenser with a tiny cotton tip applicator. You crush it like a glow stick. And then a little phenol comes out the end. And we have a tiny 3.5 millimeter camera that we can look in the ear and we can visualize it touching the membrane. So what we see there in the picture is an eardrum. And what we also see is that to the top left at the 10 o'clock position is the bone touching the eardrum. And this white spot is where the phenol has just touched. And my experience is that once that phenol is touched, the patient really amazingly feels nothing. So it's a pretty tried and true method. You have to be careful working the ear. Some of the local antibiotics are ototoxic or toxic to the ear. So you can't just use like polymyxin, neomycin drops. So we sterilize that with dilute hydrogen peroxide, and we have to sometimes do quite a little bit of cerumen removal as well. But hopefully, you know, I spoke to a patient of mine who went to Mexico. He said that the doctor there anecdotally had really good success with different inner ear, or middle ear conditions using a transtympanic method. So wrapping up, I just want to say that, again, exosomes is not approved by the FDA for the treatment or prevention of disease, but we do think that if MSC exosomes can reduce inflammation and, according to Dr. Arnold Kaplan, signal the local stem cells to regenerate and proliferate, there may be clinical improvements, and that may be explaining some of the changes we see after exosome usage. The practice of medicine is just that, you're practicing. No one ever calls it the mastery of medicine. There are things that most people who are not surgeons would not understand about remaining calm, effective, making good decisions based on knowledge, anatomy, risk assessment. It's very difficult to be a procedure-based physician, but it's somehow something that we can get our hands on literally, and we can get better and better at. It's a continuous process of learning, review, improvement, and refinement, and that's true for me as it is for everybody. Of course, in the case of chronic burnout systems, location may be more important. Where you started may be important. I had an interesting case, a patient who had fallen off a horse. She sent me her MRI of her back. She had 5 fractured vertebrae, like little, you know, crushed, not really crushed, but like, you know, if you dropped an iPhone, the cracked screen on 5 of the vertebrae, it was quite clear and quite painful. And she was taking round the clock pain medication. So I told her, well, you probably need an epidural injection because that epidural space will get to all those vertebrae. And she didn't want to spend the money, so she just got a discount IV treatment. And she actually, within 3-4 weeks, was fine. She was at the gym. And I think that's because in that case, there was acute inflammation. All the macrophages, the immune system, the blood flow had already been shifted to that area. And that's a beautiful thing. So the exosomes were more effective because she was in acute injury state. Unfortunately, in our situation, the injury is kind of over. I remember I was speaking to a rheumatologist who did hundreds, if not thousands, of knee injections. And she commented that when she takes fluid out of a person's knee and sends it to the lab, it's just dead fluid. There's no inflammation. So that's the problem there. We're not really talking about arthritis, which is inflammation. We're talking about arthrosis, and the osis is what we're really faced with, age and tendinosis, arthrosis, osteoporosis. These are burnt out stem cell niches that are no longer effectively copying, reproducing, and healing those joints. And so the premise of what we're doing is that the exosomes from these stem cells are coming in and giving, you know, newborn baby signals to regenerate. And that's why we think that in the case of chronic arthroses, it's probably better to put it in the area where they're gonna do the most action before they diffuse away. Okay, everybody, that's really what I want to talk about. If there are any questions, feel free to raise your hand or type in, and I'd be happy to address that. I don't know what the feedback is going to be like from the speaker, but we'll give it a go. I left my headphones in my car. Sorry. Okay, any questions? You can raise your hand or you can type them in the chat box. Ah, here we go. Alan from last week got a procedure and he types, Dr. Nash, on my injections last week, used ultrasound only to mark an X on my skin and injected without an ultrasound. It looks like you keep viewing with the ultrasound during the injection. Gosh, that's a good question. You can use the ultrasound to localize where you're going to go. That's a great use of it. In certain things like intraperitoneal, as I mentioned, or hip, there's anatomy that can be damaged by the needle. The guts, in the case of putting something into a belly, and then the nerve, artery, and vein, and other, you know, aberrant, maybe accessory nerve, artery, and vein coming near the hip. So the hip is another area where I like to watch the tip of the needle the whole time. And so, that's a good question. But you always want to do what is easiest. I mean, it's hard when you don't have an assistant. And even if you have an assistant, arguably it doesn't really help. I grew up in the age of video games, still play video games. So, you know, things like laparoscopic surgery, getting feedback in real time from a TV screen is natural for me. But for a lot of the old timers, they couldn't transition to laparoscopy, and some people just are not that inclined. So I think the important thing is that you should do what you're comfortable doing. Now, the consideration is that we want to be a sterile technique, especially we're injecting into joints. So I have a sterile probe cover, sterile ultrasound gel. We want to keep everything sterile. So if it's going to help me in my efficacy, and if it's going to help me in my safety, I will use an ultrasound. If it's not, if it's just going to create more hassle, then I won't. So I don't use it on the shoulders. But yeah, that's a good question. Okay, I see Tamara joined in. Hello, Tamara. I hope we're going to meet up tonight for karaoke. I'm feeling some Louis Armstrong in me. Dan Barr asks, I was wondering whether you think research into exosomes from induced pluripotent stem cells may offer improved efficacy over MSCs. Well, I don't know Dan Barr. I don't know why he's asking the question, but I don't think research into exosomes from iPSCs is a good idea. I think induced pluripotency of stem cells is a non-starter to begin with. For those that don't know, the Yamanaka factors are these three or four proteins which can be introduced to cause any cell to de-differentiate and become more stem-like in nature. So what you're really creating are like zombie cells. And although it was the subject of a Nobel Prize and a lot of optimism and seed money research, we really don't want to take cells that are already grown up and make them act like children. I mean, it's like getting 60-year-old people to go to first grade. We don't want that. Everything has its own ontogeny, if you will, its own life course. So induced pluripotency is just a Frankenstein sort of experiment. I'm not a big fan. If you're going to use cells, you want them to be in a pristine epigenetic and genetic state. And the unfortunate fact of the matter is that by the time cells are differentiated and have been around, they're damaged and they have problems. So they are abnormal, as from young Frankenstein. Any other questions from the audience? Absolutely. Anybody want to speak? We could try the audio. I haven't seen any raised hands here. Alan Kay asks, regarding how much fluid to inject, the doctor injected the point of pain from the pressure of the fluid, okay? 1 cc in the knee, 1 cc in the hip, and 3 cc's in my two locations in the facet joints. I don't usually use pain as an endpoint personally. The knee can handle a lot of volume, you know, much more than that, like 20, 30 cc's, no problem. It's just the rate of introduction, how fast you inject, is generally the determinant of pain, especially if you're using distraction techniques like these vibrational assist devices. I want to call it that. It's really just a sex toy about this big, but people can tolerate quite a bit of volume in the knees. That's not usually the problem. The hip also, you could get 2-3 cc's into the hip if you inject slowly, no problem. So I'm not really sure. Everything is kind of subjective. And when you talk about cc's, you can talk about 1 billion per cc or 3 billion per cc. So that's also a factor. Any other questions? Are you feeling better, Alan? By the way, we were hopeful that the things they injected were going to help you. You're going to be playing in the golf tournament. Alan last Monday got injected with not exosomes, but stem cells and some placental matrix, I think. Not yet. The rate of introduction was fast. Didn't use distraction. Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm the same way. Like I injected myself. It was quite painful. And I didn't really give myself the courtesy of the local anesthesia either. So no one likes pain. And that's partly why I did this webinar, to demystify a little bit of what we do. So the wonderful things that we've kind of developed over, we used to spray on this freeze spray. But I find that with the distraction, the little vibrator, they usually don't even feel the 32 gauge needle. That's a kind of a specialty needle. And so when you numb up the skin, they don't feel the bigger needle. And so, you know, pain is something that nobody likes. So as long as you go slowly and you avoid excess rapid fluid introduction disrupting the tissues, most of these procedures are pretty relatively painless, you know. Of course, the experience of pain and trauma is different in other people, and people who've had traumatic experiences can get sort of triggered and amplified. So you have to be very, very careful and sensitive to that. And the patient, you know, always can back out of the procedure. But yeah, there's a lot of things in awake patient procedures that you need to kind of get comfortable with. I remember I had one patient, I was injecting her nose. And she just about kicked me in the groin as I was doing it. And she laughed later. She goes, oh, it really didn't hurt. I was just so anxious. So everybody's different, and that's part of clinical medicine. Alan says he's happy to talk. Turn on my speaker. We'll hear what the gentleman has to say.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Park.
Sure.
Just again, I want to thank you for the voluminous amount of information you're putting out there to the general public. I mean, all your blogs, your webinars, the videos, the 9-part videos. So it's been a great education for me, and glad to have that going into my procedure. I want a couple other questions. What's the benefit of the nasal brain injection? What do you try to get out of that? Or what are you going for?
Yeah, I mean, as I said, I think it gets in the brain pretty effectively. My dad, who was a physician, always used to warn, you know, don't pick around, don't do stuff in the nose because it's so close to the brain. And anatomically, you know, on a microstructural level, it is close to the brain. So I remember when I did my first nasal injection to myself to see what would happen. It was a technique I had learned during stem cell training. But of course, I did stem cells. I didn't feel anything, so I abandoned that. I said, well, let's see how these suckers do in the nose. So I injected my nose, and I'll never forget, at 1 hour, it went to my brain, and I felt like right before you hit the top of a roller coaster, that exhilaration must have been a catecholamine excitement or something. And then exactly at 2 hours, my hair started standing on end. And to this day, almost 3 years later, I can voluntarily pilo-erect, which means I can make my hair stand on end anytime I want. So that to me is prima facie evidence that it changed something in my brain or unlocked a potential program that's there for everyone. But that's why, you know, my brain works pretty quick right now. I don't really like to do any more nasal injections. I don't want to do any more modifications. But the idea, to answer your question, is to go to the brain. And as with other areas, decrease the inflammation and maybe signal regeneration in the form of remyelination or what have you. So we do see a common report among older people, especially women, that their focus is better. They're able to read. I guess reading is a problem when you're older because you lack the concentration or the focus or the, I don't know what it is, but I've heard that anecdote a couple of times. So we're hoping to heal the brain, repair it, and increase function. And I know I'm going to go see my mom later on tonight after I go singing with Tamara. Hey, Tamara. And then she's just hilarious. She was bragging to the person we were meeting with that she's going to live to 130. So I just think that reducing inflammation, increasing the function, increasing the memory, hopefully that's what we're getting out of it.
Awesome. Thanks for that.
You got it.
I could use some more cognition.
I'm in my
early 60s.
You know, a lot of people could. And another common report I get is that the ability to find words is easier, which is a pretty subtle thing. And maybe it's bias and just people wishful thinking that they didn't waste their money. But I do get that a lot. It's like, I don't know if it helped, but I used to have trouble finding words and now I don't. But there's a plethora of information on the blogs, as you mentioned. And thank you. You're one of the few people that's seen and read most of it. You know, things like if you have trauma-based double vision, tinnitus, those have been helped. Also, face blindness, the ability to recognize faces, a particular region in the brain, that's been helped. So, you know, the brain is really arguably the center of a lot of what's going on in our lives. So, you know, the hypothalamic pituitary function controls hormone. There may be an aging clock there. You know, I think it's really important to keep that buffed up and fresh if we can. Thanks, Alan. We'll look forward to hearing more about your clinical course. Take care.
No, don't mean to monopolize, but I got one more. So related, okay. Intravenous injections. What does that do for the body versus going right at the knee or right at the hip or something like that?
Yeah, I mean, if you got an acute injury, like the reason I got into this was Sheldon Jordan, who's one of the keynote speakers this year at A4M. He fell on his motorcycle and broke like 7 ribs, his ankle. And he was up there 4 weeks later telling a story of how he snuck $25 billion into his IV and he recovered so quickly. It was a miracle. No findings on his x-ray. So I thought, well, either this guy's a liar or there's something here. So the thought, as I said, with the lady who fell off the horse in Mexico, I thought she would need it in the back. But because there was so much inflammation going on in her back, the blood system was increased from inflammation, vascular neogenesis. It went right to where it was needed. But so the rationale in a nutshell is that it's like putting food coloring in a swimming pool. Like, it's going to go everywhere, but is it going to have an effect? I mean, we're talking about billions, whereas the number of cells is trillions. And arguably, the number of exosomes is in the quadrillions. So if you just have a little dab, is that going to do you, or do you need to start off where it's needed? So my feeling is, you know, if you're just trying to generally affect everything, like your circulation's bad, you know, it's going to help everywhere, but it's in a minute amount. So I would say if you have problems with your circulation in your feet, cold feet, put it in the foot arteries or around them, get it started where it's needed. Because the diffusion will happen, but it's better, I think, in my opinion, to start it where it's needed. Unless you have an acute injury and the body already knows where all the action is, then just put it in the IV, it'll go where it's needed.
And is that a bag IV or injection?
Oh, I didn't talk about that. Thank you. Yeah, no, with certain things, you want a slow IV injection, like cells. I'm going to be doing a cell procedure on a gentleman who has autologous stem cells. And even though they're autologous and there's no media, they recommend hanging it in a 100 cc bag if you're giving it IV. But no, with this, it's just an IV push. It's not immunogenic. It doesn't cause a reaction or anaphylaxis. If you have a reaction or anaphylaxis, I have things like epinephrine, steroids, I have pulse oximeter, things to kind of resuscitate you, ammonia salts. But no, that's a good question. It is not slow IV push, it's fast IV push.
Sorry, my dogs are barking.
Okay.
And then lastly, is that, do you have a recommended number of billions or triple strength that you want to do in the IV?
I mean, you know, a lot of people for maintenance, for general health, anti-aging are doing 15 billion every 2 months. That's a good way to go. You have to always be careful. You know, I mentioned there was an A-list celebrity actor, producer, director, and he got shingles. And that's right there, I think, on my consent that you can get viral activation. from these because the immune system shifts away from viral surveillance. So it's always best to have a doctor that can prescribe you Valtrex or something on a moment's notice. So yeah, you have to be careful.
All right, great. Turn my speaker off. I've had it.
Thanks, Alan.
Let some other people talk.
Yeah, I might be getting my Texas license, so we might be able to meet someday soon.
That'd be terrific.
Yeah, take care now. Bye-bye.
Thanks.
All right. One question from Dan Barr asks, do you find exosomes can help with nerve regeneration, peripheral neuropathy? Yeah, I do. And I think that not in all cases, sometimes the nerve damage, as in my friend Crystal, is too severe. She had a really complicated fracture, reconstructive surgery. And I think there's just some ongoing re-injury to her radial nerve at the humeral site. But other people have had significant improvement in their peripheral neuropathy. The general way to do it is to find the nerve going to that part of the anatomy and then inject all around it. And even you can see it going right into the nerve sheath, like the sausage casing. John Wenger asks, how would you inject into the thymus gland? Well, I don't think I would inject in the thymus gland, but something I could think about. Of course, the thymus is the heart of the immune system. It's right here above the breastplate, and it's where the T cells from your bone marrow go to study what's foreign and what's friendly, and arguably is one of the root causes of aging via immune senescence. So maybe that's a great idea to do. Got to think about that. It'd probably be pretty easy to do. It's a very regressed, fatty-like organ, just millimeters thick in older people, but it's probably doable. I know there's scientists like I know and met the Fahey guy who tries to regenerate the thymus with a cocktail. There, you might be onto something there, John. Any other questions? All right, super good. I'm not sure what we're going to talk about next week, but thank you everybody for joining. This is Dr. Ed Park completing a lecture. Sorry about my wayward hair today, and we'll see you in the next episode. Thank you.